the dream, you are falling, lost in the listening distance as dark locks in. Nightfall. Good evening. Tonight, we present a celebrated but little-known classic from the pen of William Hope Hodgson, specially adapted for radio by Len Peterson. It's called The Stone Ship.
Where menacing things? At sea? Well, where more menacing and terrifying. One trip in the small park, the Alfred Jessop, just before I got my ticket. Oh, did we come across a phantasmagoria to make the flesh creep? As mine, I pray God, will never creep again. We were 20 days out of London and well into the tropics. There's no land nearer than Africa, 1,000 miles eastward. A full day without a breath of wind. The night found us with our lower sails up in the bunt lines. Yeah, I was on the 8 to midnight watch, my ears alive to the enormous silence of the calm sea you can only know in an old-time windjammer like the Jessop. The one sound, that faint moaning of the masts and gear, chafing and whining to the occasional sly roll of the ship.
Guy?
Hmm?
You hear that?
What? Hear what, Broder?
It's a weird thing. Off the port bow.
Oh. Sounds like a brook. Running down a hillside.
And no land. Land?
Land near in 1,000 fathoms under our barnacles.
Stop it. Listen.
Oh, what's that weird smell?
Lord love us. At sea since I was a shaver. Never heard the like of that.
Go call the second mate, Andrews, and you hurry.
Porter! Down on the lookout!
Oh, second mate's heard it too. They're coming on the run.
What the blazes are you doing?
Nothing, sir. You're keeping watch.
The what's up? Broder, to play.
Something off the port bow, sir.
Yeah, running water.
Then croaking. Groaning. But that stopped.
If you've got your night glasses, sir, would you...
I can't see a thing.
Yeah, this mist.
Oh, what a devil of a stink.
Mm. Oh, what's that?
Look, sir. Light, just off the bow.
Dupre, take the glasses. See if you can make it out.
Moving.
It isn't, it isn't.
Ahoy there! Ahoy! Ahoy there!
Light's flickered out.
No. There now.
Shooting. At us.
Missed if they are.
Keep an eye out. I'm going to call the captain.
Better to call God, I think.
In no time, the second was back with the captain, mate, and third all in their shirts and trousers.
Anything fresh to pick?
The night's gone, sir.
But that sound of running waters, it's still out there.
Captain Jessop, owner of our ship, and the mates stood some time along the port rail, watching through their night glasses and listening.
Ahoy! Ahoy there!
Captain, should we investigate?
Yes. Barometer steady. Be no wind for a while. Clear one of the lifeboats, Mr. Andrews. Pick out 6 men. I'll be back when I get my coat.
Away up with you, Dupre and Broder. Get the cover of the port lifeboat.
Aye, aye, sir.
And bail her out.
We had the boat into the water within 20 minutes. Broder and I and 4 others from our watch were picked to go. Captain Jessop came down the end of the main topsail halyards into the boat and the second mate after him.
Cast off. Mr. Andrews, take the tiller.
Aye, sir.
We rowed into a warm, wet mist.
Captain Jessop took a heavy revolver from the second mate. I knew then he'd a notion, too, we might be moving into something dangerous. I made certain me sheath knife was clear.
Take your bearings by the sound, Mr. Andrews.
This is crazy. A running brook in mid-ocean?
Oh, good.
Good Lord.
What's wrong?
There's something in the water. He's slithering and writhing around my arm. He's clutching at it. It's got a tight hold on it, sir, with its mouth.
All the splashing. It's got to swap the boat.
Backwater all. Put some beef into it now.
Back. It's let go of the oar, sir.
Oh, in blazes, is there no lantern in this boat so we can see what cotton prays over?
Back now. Back.
What the devil's that?
Whatever it was, it came a good bit out of the water to make that much splash.
Back on. Back, men. Back. Back.
We wanted nothing of a monster we couldn't see above or in the water. We pulled like madmen to get back to the ship and aboard.
Well then, men. After the steward served out a tot of grog each, we fetched a couple of anchor lights and the deck bullseye. Those who are willing can come with me. We'll have another go at finding out what devil's work that is yonder. I'll not order any of you to come. Those who do, take an axe each, good weapons in any trouble.
We'll all come, sir.
Aye, sir. Aye.
Not afeard, eh? Well, we'll see.
Armed with the lights, axes, and grog, we felt ready to face anything. And down we went again into the heaving boat.
Lash one of the lamps to a boat hook for over the bows up there. Should light up the water a couple of fathoms ahead of us. There's chances something coming at us without our knowing. Let's go. Cast off the painter.
Now it's got my oar, sir. Whatever it is, a monster.
Something whirled and beat about in the halo of light over the bows of the boat. Smashed the boat hook and the lamp.
The monster's pulled the oar out of my hands. Gone.
Hold fast. Stop rowing so I can shine this bullseye down and catch a glimpse of that creature. Hold steady.
Lord in heaven.
The sight. The water was thick and living for yards round the boat with the hugest eels I ever saw.
Oh, mother of God. Save me. Hide me.
Dig in, men. Row on. These eels are sight, but don't explain the almighty sounds out yonder. Row, lads.
I can't. I got no oar.
Yeah, I'll keep flashing this bullseye around. They don't like the light, those eels. It'll keep them off the oars.
No, sir. One's got mine.
There, see? Flash a light on him and he's gone. Row, lads, row. Mr. Andrews, keep her dead on the noise ahead.
Aye, sir.
But as we rowed, other sounds began to loom up around us. Strange cathedral-like echoes.
That's very odd.
Very odd. Very odd.
Good
Lord.
We lay on our oars, staring round into the darkness ahead. The old man swung the beam of his lamp upwards, making circles in the night, and we saw something looming vaguely through the mist, and then lost it.
Pull a few strokes, all. More. A bit more. Easy.
Now we saw the thing plainly. A strangely made mast, standing up out of the mist.
Ship ahoy!
Ship ahoy!
Ship ahoy!
Ship ahoy there!
Ship ahoy
there! Ship ahoy there!
That's no ship's mast as ever I've seen.
Ahoy!
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 Ahoy
there!
Ahoy there! Ahoy there!
Good Lord!
The captain readied his revolver, but didn't fire. I gripped my axe.
Stand ready to backwater. Mr. Andrews, watch my hand. Steer as I tell you.
I could see the thing distinctly now. She was a ship, right enough.
But a strange one. She lay very high out of the water, and water was streaming down her sides.
There's your running water. What on earth has she built her?
It looks like stone, Captain.
A stone ship? Floating in mid-Atlantic?
And slime on her. A Davy Jones ship, by God.
And stinks like a corpse.
Ship ahoy! Ship ahoy! Ship ahoy! Ship ahoy!
No one aboard there, sir. Shall I put the boat alongside?
Yes, let's get to the bottom of this queer thing. A few more strokes there, and we'll board her.
And the look and feel of that ghostly ship when we got aboard. Stone. Stone everywhere.
Makes no sense.
Keep a sharp lookout, lads, and your axes at the ready. So if there's anything weird and wild...
Did you ever hear of stone mast?
A solid stone ship. Why, she must weigh 1,000 tons more than she's buoyancy to carry.
What was that?
Don't go imagining. Enough solid unnatural fact here without adding to it.
It's not possible, such a ship.
No, Broder. But you're aboard here.
Debray! Sir. A post of honor for you. Lead the way. I'll cover with the bullseye.
Aye, aye, sir.
Yeah, we'll try aft first.
How's the raised deck here? You made of anything different?
That's what we call stone at home.
Let's take a peek in the deck house first.
She's as strange as anything I've seen since I took the sea.
We made our way up the sloping deck. The fore part of the deck house had 2 square window holes that stared out at us curiously, ominously. And suddenly, something, a great shaggy head of red hair rose slowly into sight through the window nearest us.
Debré? What's got you?
Oh, my God. In that window. Oh, what is it, Captain? No, it's gone.
What?
At the port window, sir. A great red-haired head came up and then went in a moment.
Bosh, man. You're fancying things. Ease up your nerves.
I did see it, sir. A red-haired monster.
Slow it, Dupre. The deck house, look. It's empty. No, let's go round to the door. The masons that built this unholy thing made doors.
All the same, lad. Keep your axes ready.
No door. Solid stone, right across.
But squared, aren't they, like a door? There was one, or was meant to be.
Broder, have a whack at it with the butt end of your axe.
All right. Stand away. Give him room.
Stone and more stone. By gum, what is she, this ship?
I didn't wait for the others. The skipper had put me so on edge, I stepped bang in through the open doorway, my axe held short and very ready. But nothing inside.
Find your red-haired monster, Dupre.
Shall we try below, sir? The cabin. There. Stone steps leading down. If you'll give me some light.
The worthy Dupre leads the van. Take the light. We'll follow.
From the look of him and the sound of his voice, the skipper was as jumpy with fear as the rest of us. A man almost callous to the normal seafaring fears. But this was not normal. I counted 7 steps down. And then my foot splashed into water.
Why are you stopping to pray?
I'm in water. More steps. Up to my thighs in water. But I found floor.
You can walk about?
Yes. Yes, it gets no deeper. Are you coming down, sir? Another door. A jar. It's opening. Somebody or something pushing it open.
Debré, you in trouble?
Oh, no, sir. It's a play of the light made it seem to be opening.
It's a bit ajar. The door won't budge.
Take your axe to it.
Yes.
Let's see if I can loose the hinges.
God damn it. I warn us to pray before you go busting things.
I'm sorry, sir. I feel safer with that doorway open and not half open.
Well, what's inside?
More stone.
Careful. Bad air can kill you.
That's the same stink everywhere on this ship.
I'd like to find something not stone. Now, what's that cabinet over there, Dupre? Use your axe.
Right, sir. An order this time, sir.
An order.
Well, what you got? Fine old wines?
It's empty.
Well, shall we move along?
The less we find, the more mystery.
The skipper, second mate, and the others crowded out, and I thrust my hand into the busted stone cabinet twice and shoved what I'd caught a glimpse of, gleaming jewels and gems, into the side pocket of my coat. I'd not known till then I was such a fella. And no one noticed my secret caper, though I quivered with excitement. Oh, the blinding thought that I was rich. It blotted out all the horror of this stone ship. And there was more glitter back in the stone cabinet, and I hoped as we explored I might get a chance to slip back after it.
The light, Dupre, damn you. It's lagging. Bring the light.
Why?
Why? Well, to get past the archway into that alcove, to explore.
Yeah, and ransack its treasures.
Oh, yes. Full of promise, this ship, I must say. The beam of the bullseye. Light the way with it, Dupre. Now go in, we'll follow.
I went in through the black gape of the archway. It was a large alcove, and a table ran along the center with its top no more than a few inches above the water. On each side, massive old chairs. And at the far end, something seated at the end of the table, its face bowed forward upon its arms.
Like everything else in this mad ship, that man, he's all stone.
And over here, a huge clutching hand sticking out of the water. Have you ever seen such a huge hand?
Is there anything not a stone? Flesh to grow in stone.
Captain.
Yes, Dupre.
I've gone mad.
Get a grip on yourself, man.
But over there, will you look? There's another head of a man above the water. A stone.
No surprise that by now.
Look at the hair on the head, Captain. There's a mass of red hair. And it's growing so fast you can see it sprouting and writhing.
Lord, save us. Lord, save us.
It's what I saw before at the window, car. Let's get out of here.
Yes, clear out. Clear out.
A mad dash up the stairs, the others, and I stood dumb, watching the hair growing in horrible fashion, rippling down over the forehead and spreading over the stone face until it hid it completely. I hurled me axe at it, and then I backed crazily for the door. I reached the stairs, caught at the stone rail, pulled myself up, and I dashed along the deck to where the men were tumbling over the side.
Down into the boat, Dupre. Give me the lamp, I'll pass it down.
Aye, sir.
Get a move on you. I'll untie the lines.
The captain had his nerve back. This was more the man I knew. I went over the side, and as I landed on the thwart of our lifeboat, we heard a strange noise from aboard the ship, as if some stone object were trundling down the sloping decks. And we all got the horrors.
The stone men!
Captain! Jump! Jump!
Awful sounds aboard the ship, and the captain's shadow swung out huge against the mist, and then suddenly turned with lamp and revolver.
What's he firing at?
The stone men, you think?
Look at the red hair!
And we all saw it. The coiling red hair we'd seen growing on the monstrous stone head in the cabin was now curling round the captain. The ship began to cant upward.
Men! Make your way back to the jetty! Save yourselves!
The stone ship lurched away from us, showed its keel, and fell clean over on its side.
And then a huge wave come at us and half filled the boat.
Captain! Captain!
She's going down.
She'll crush us. Pull away, men, so we don't get sucked under. Put your backs to it, man!
We returned to the Alfred Jessop and sat out the night on deck, keeping a sharp lookout. I took a peek at what I'd grabbed. A ruby, an emerald, a topaz, some hammered slugs of gold, and four diamonds. I cursed myself for not grabbing more, till I thought of our captain going down in the stone ship.
Oh, no. I thought with dawn just breaking, we'd be done with these unearthly sounds.
What's that out in the mist?
Tremendous shapes seem to stand towering away to port and starboard.
All hands on deck. Grab axes and capstan bars and stand by till we find out what this devilment is out yonder.
We lined the rail and stared away.
Rocks!
Rocks.
The sea around us was dotted with reefs of jagged rock thrusting up out of the water. Stone spires and arches.
Josephine, how did we take the ship through that without stoving her in?
Bottom of the seas just riz up here, quiet and gentle during the night. And it's God's mercy we're not atop one of those earthquake ornaments.
Everything that had looked and sounded mad and incredible in the night became now in the daylight natural. The stone ship had been thrust out of the sea with the slow lifting of the sea bottom. The water pouring out of her was the running brook that we heard. The echoing was the bounce of sound back and forth between the rocks. We rowed out for one last look around for the skipper on the chance we'd find his body. But we didn't.
Look! Huh? Right under our lifeboat. Stone cannon on the rocks.
And hair on it. That red hair. And on the reef.
That? Those? They're big, hairy sea caterpillars. Strong enough to kill an elephant.
And kill the captain.
But don't all lean over for a look, or we'll capsize.
You're a wooden sailing ship like our own, you think? Went to the bottom and got changed by some natural mineralizing into stone. And the men, too, drowned in the cabin.
Hey, very likely.
And the varying lights.
Well, any number of deep-sea phosphorescent creatures trapped, but still moving about on the upheaved reefs could make them.
But those bangs. Those tremendous bangs.
Ah, sure, the rocks rising and splitting.
The rocks don't roar. We heard roaring last night.
Those enormous 4-5-ton deep-sea creatures trapped in the rising reefs with air escaping from their snouts or their mouths could give you those roars. Right?
Who will ever believe this but us?
No one aboard ever learned about the jewels. I sold the ruby, badly, so I've learned since. £20,000 I got for it. Ah, but I don't spoil my pleasure by grumbling. The volcanic reefs, which disappeared again in 1883, were charted in the old nautical mercury of 1879 under the name of the Alfred Jessop Shoals Reefs, named after our captain who discovered them and sank into the sea with them. To become like that tomb of a ship he went down in. Stone.
have just heard William Hope Hodgson's The Stone Ship in a special dramatization by Len Peterson. Dupre, the narrator, was played by Chris Wiggins, with Art McDonald as Captain, Eric House as Broder, and Greg as the second mate. Our recording with sound effects by Bill Robinson. Editors are John Douglas and Earl Toppings, with the production assistance of Nina Callahan. Nightfall is produced and directed for CBC Radio by Bill Howell.